everyone. Welcome to City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel. City officials gathered to open the latest addition to Atlanta Fire Rescue, a fire station that also houses an APD mini precinct. City Talk's Troy Danicus shows us how the community will play a part in this new station.
It was a cold and wet December afternoon when ground was broken on the new Fire Station 28. Now, less than 8 months later, city leaders are celebrating the newest addition to Atlanta Fire Rescue and the APD. The opening of Fire Station 28 is on track with Mayor Kasim Reed's goal of improving public safety throughout the city.
What you're going to see in the public safety spaces, we're going to do more and more and more to make sure that when you pick up that phone, that there's going to be a receptive voice on the other end, and they're going to be first responders who are ready, willing, able, and supportive, and in a position to respond to your needs.
Atlanta Fire Rescue, under the Reed administration, has thrived. All of its firehouses are fully staffed, four new stations have been opened with three more planned, and renovations are in the works for some of the older stations, including Fire Station No. 7 in the historic West End, which was shuttered in 2008 due to budget cuts. The station is also home to an APD mini precinct that will be used by officers in Zones 1 and 2.
The Atlanta Police Department's new mission really is to provide a safer Atlanta by partnering with our communities to reduce crime. And this is an example of just that.
A large community room was included in the design to allow residents to hold events there. In fact, the first event is already in the works.
We have just booked the first, which will be an annual Christmas party that will take place right here at this fire station every year from now on.
Both Council President Cesar Mitchell and Public Safety Chair Michael Julian Bond say the partnership between public safety and the community will be essential for the future of the city.
This community room is incorporated in the design of this building because it really represents an understanding that we can't get anything done if we don't include citizens in the work that we do.
Everyone, not just the public servants who do an outstanding job putting themselves in harm's way, but the community will be seated around the table in this community as an example for the rest of the city.
For City Talk, I'm Troy Danicus.
The weekend after the grand opening, the community came out for an open house to get a look at the new building. The Department of Energy recognizes Atlanta's Better Buildings Challenge for its leadership. Atlanta beat its first year goal of using sustainable building practices on 2 million square feet of real estate. Partners in the Better Buildings Challenge, including the Omni Hotel, have committed over 50 million square feet to go green. Improvements have so far reduced energy costs by 2.5%. At that rate, buildings around the city are on track to meet President Obama's goal of reducing energy consumption 20% by the year 2020. Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport was host to a regional conference for the Airports Council International. ACI North America represents local, regional, and state governing bodies that own and operate commercial airports in the U.S. and Canada. Mayor Reed was on hand to welcome the group to Atlanta. The mission of ACI North America is to advocate policies and provide services that strengthen the ability of commercial airports to serve their passengers, their customers, and their communities. Some members of the Atlanta City Council toured the recently completed Concourse D at Hartsfield-Jackson. With several new escalators connecting different levels, the expansion brings better passenger flow, adds restaurants and retail shops, and enhances access to the plane, train, and the transportation mall. Aviation General Manager Lewis Miller says the expansion improves the overall experience for thousands of passengers traveling through Concourse D every day. Councilmember Kwanzaa Hall, the Office of Planning, and Central Atlanta Progress have all partnered for a collaborative community-driven process to update zoning regulations for the MLK Landmark District. This is the first time zoning policies have been reviewed since the historic district was created in 1989. This community process will help ensure that the area gets the right kind of new investment that protects Sweet Auburn's historic resources while unlocking opportunities for contemporary business and retail uses. The group plans to have the process completed this fall and hopefully have a decision from the City Council by the end of this year or early 2014. Cars were not allowed at Atlanta Streets Alive, a festival on the streets of Atlanta. Atlanta Streets Alive closed nearly a 3-mile section of Peachtree Street to cars and opened the road to people who wanted to be outside. The route ran from Ellis Street past Ponce de Leon Avenue and ended at Spring Street.
But people are out on the streets, no cars, riding bikes, rollerblading, walking, jogging, skating, doing salsa, tango, celebrating life, celebrating health, and just enjoying our city in a way that you usually don't get a chance to do it.
The event was organized by the Atlanta Bicycle Coalition to inspire a car-free day in Atlanta. Councilmember George Shepherd held a reception and proclamation presentation for Mrs. Evelyn Lowry. Mrs. Lowry is the founder of the Civil Rights Heritage Tour. Earlier this year, Shepherd and students from District 12's After 5 program joined Mrs. Lowry and SCLC women on that tour in Alabama. Shepherd's group got a chance to meet people who made history and to visit significant places in the civil rights movement. Many elected officials, national leaders, celebrities, international dignitaries, and students have taken the tour over the years. Councilman Michael Bunn gave special recognition to William T. Roby, a respected real estate professional who spent several years as a college professor, a certified real estate appraiser, and a licensed real estate broker. The Empire Board of Realists honored him by establishing the William T. Roby Undergraduate Scholarship for students enrolled in a college at the Atlanta University Center. He has 63 years of outstanding contributions to the real estate profession. The City of Atlanta paid tribute to Battalion Chief Cameron Dixon, who started his career with the fire department in 1987. Now he's with the Airport Operations Division, managing day-to-day operations, coordinating emergency responses, and supervising fire crews. Dixon is a member of the International Association of Black Professional Firefighters and a former president of its Atlanta chapter. The city recognized the veteran firefighter with a Phoenix Award from the mayor and a proclamation from Councilman C.T. Martin. Invest Atlanta's recent hackathon, dubbed the Govathon, yields two new web-based applications. ParkFind is a website that allows you to search for city parks and the amenities offered at each location. The site then links you to the city's iParks page, where residents and visitors can reserve park facilities. Focus on Results, or For Atlanta, tracks the performance and function of city departments. That app will be available to the public later this year. Hurricane season runs from June 1st through November 30th, and City Talk wants to help you prepare in the event of a hurricane. First, know the difference between a watch and a warning. A watch means hurricane conditions threaten your area within 48 hours, while a warning is more serious. It means a hurricane can strike the area within 36 hours. Next, have an emergency plan prepared and ready to go. Plan ahead with your family on evacuation options and have a disaster kit that includes water, food, flashlight and batteries, and a first aid kit. And always obey evacuation orders.
We all know that hurricanes are primarily coastal events, but they can spread their effects well inland. Tornadoes, flooding, severe thunderstorms, and that might cause the Red Cross to have to activate shelters for large numbers of people.
For more information about how to prepare for a natural disaster, visit the Red Cross's website at redcross.org. Community leaders in District 11 come together to discuss issues facing their area. And City Council President Cesar Mitchell is here. Stay with us. Husband, father, attorney, and council president, Cesar Mitchell is a native Atlantan who has served the city through a number of civic, legal, and community organizations. He's proud to be a Mays High School Raider, a Morehouse man, and a graduate of UGA's School of Law. As the 7th president of the Atlanta City Council, Cesar Mitchell presides over all full council meetings, selects committee chairs, and appoints council members to various committees. Before being elected council president, Mitchell served 8 years as a citywide council member, where he advocated for safer communities, authored key legislation, and introduced several initiatives. Mitchell is committed to the education and enrichment of Atlanta's young people. He co-sponsors a college prep series twice a year to help middle school and high school students get ready for college. He also spearheaded a campus safety task force to address crime on college campuses that led to a student safety advisory group, which works to keep students safe in and around Atlanta campuses. President Mitchell, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
You recently hosted your second annual Back to Business Conference. Why do you feel it's important to host events such as this?
Well, it was really a wonderful conference. It was an opportunity for us to bring together the wonderful businesses that make up what I would call the economic fabric of our city, and give them an opportunity to interact with one another, but also to learn more about opportunities at every level of government, but also opportunities in the private sector. So we provided a venue, essentially, for these businesses, both local, small, minority, women-owned, medium-sized businesses, and even large businesses, to interact with other large corporations, but also to interact with what I would call supply chain managers for corporations, as well as supply chain managers in government, which we really call procurement officers and compliance officers. So it was a really wonderful opportunity to learn and grow and network.
You hosted your first Twitter chat. How do you think social media helps people connect with elected officials?
Well, you know, I'll tell you, I'm relatively new to the social media universe, and I've found that people really do communicate a lot through social media. So the Twitter chat that we did a couple of weeks ago was really an opportunity to engage what I would call the social media universe in a conversation about crime in our city. As you know, our crime statistics indicate that crime is down, but you get a lot of complaints when you're in the community about those crimes that really make citizens feel uncomfortable, that chip away at their quality of life. And so we wanted to have a conversation to get a feel for what people thought about it. And what we found in the Twitter chat is that not only did we get complaints, obviously, but we really got a lot of suggestions. And that's the beauty of social media that makes it almost different from having a town hall meeting. And you go to a town hall meeting kind of in an assembly hall in a community center, and citizens will come and they will give you their specific complaint. But what happens for whatever reason in social media is that people will give you their complaints, but they also kind of give you their ideas, and they give you their thoughts, and they bring a certain degree of anticipation and certainly even optimism to the issues and ideas that they have. And I think that's in part because social media is not just a place where people communicate, but it's also a place where people actually express themselves and express their creativity and kind of the things that they're thinking about.
Congratulations on being selected to the 2013 class of Henry Crown Fellows.
Well, yeah, thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Why is now a good time to participate in this program, and what do you hope to get out of it?
Well, it's really interesting. The Aspen Institute is what you would call a nonpartisan policy and educational kind of think tank or organization. And so you're never too old to learn and to grow through exploration of ideas, exchange of ideas around policy, around social issues, around all the other disciplines, of course, that impact a community like Atlanta. And so being selected as a part of the Henry Crown Fellowship Program really is an honor, because it will give me an opportunity to interact with other young folks who are involved in business, who are involved in philanthropy, who are involved in government, to discuss kind of the issues of the day, but also to explore new ideas and creative and innovative ways to be a part of not just the business fabric or the political fabric, but really the overall notion of how we can be a part of a holistic fabric to make our communities better. So I'm really excited about the opportunity. It's essentially a two-year program. Some folks thought that maybe I was going to do this full-time, but it's not a full-time fellowship. I go away selected weeks over the next 24 months for essentially this training and interaction. And so I'm really excited about it. I hope that what I learn from this fellowship opportunity I can bring back in service to the citizens of Atlanta.
All right, President Mitchell, thank you so much.
Thank you.
We'll tell you about an organization that caters to elderly citizens in East Atlanta. And NFL players lend a hand to help young men have a productive summer. Back in a moment. Not long ago, Mayor Reed celebrated the city's recreation centers with the opening of the Centers of Hope. Thomasville Recreation Center in Southeast Atlanta is designated as a Center of Hope, and with that, Thomasville received a large grant to enhance the educational programs that go on inside the center. But during a recent visit to the rec center, Channel 26 found the outside of Thomasville getting a facelift as well.
It's a busy day here at Thomasville Recreation Center in Southeast Atlanta. Soon this brick wall will be covered in colors of hope.
My name is Stephanie Gassman. I am an artist. I make wall reliefs that protrude from the wall.
Eddie Granderson oversees the public art program for the Office of Cultural Affairs. He knew Stephanie Gassman would be the perfect artist to create the mural of hope that will adorn the entrance of Thomasville Recreation Center.
Reach for the stars is their motto. And of course, we wanted to have figures and represent some of the activities at the center here.
Thomasville is one of the city's centers of hope, offering young people a safe, structured learning environment. Programs at this Center of Hope help strengthen academics, character building, fitness, and service to the surrounding community. For Gassman, her goal is to create an artistic relief wall mural that exudes all of the positive activity going on behind these brick walls.
What I want to happen is that people will know that something really exciting is going on within this building. I want them to come by and say, wow, there is, it's not just an ordinary looking brick building.
Gassman even enlisted the help of young artists here at Thomasville. They painted the stars that will be included in the mural.
These are the stars that were decorated by all the children here, and they'll be installed as a ceiling border in one of the rooms. But this is my first time seeing them. This is just wonderful. And across the total top of the art is Reach for the Stars. It really is an expression of, I think, the joy that goes on here and all the really important work.
Tons of volunteers turn out in force for the Year of Boulevard Spring Community Cleanup. And it was a good day for some neighborhood groups who got sizable checks to help with their involvement in the community. These nonprofits sponsor summer camps along the Boulevard corridor.
We gave a $40,000 grant from the Community Development Block Grant Program to Truly Living Well Urban Farm, to Renaissance Learning Center, and to Operation Peace. All great programs that are going to provide young people in our community with a summer of possibility.
Councilman Kwanza Hall is very proud of the Yoke Boulevard Initiative, which combines the efforts of Atlanta Police Zone 6, local churches, neighborhood associations, city departments, and several other organizations. Councilmember Keisha Bottoms hosted a community leaders dinner to discuss issues facing District 11. MPU representatives and a number of ministers and business leaders were present. The councilwoman provided an update on community projects and heard from constituents who are concerned about a need for more viable businesses on Campbellton Road. Bottoms says the smaller, informal setting was a great opportunity to discuss ways that they can work together to improve the community. Council President Mitchell joined the United Way in celebrating its 20th anniversary VIP, Volunteer Improvement Program. The training program is designed to develop and enhance leadership skills and increase placement and retention of individuals from Metro Atlanta communities. VIP alumni from the past two decades gathered for the event.
Well, actually, I'm a VIP alum many moons ago, and it was a really wonderful opportunity. It taught me a lot about board governance, about serving on nonprofit boards, and really even beyond that, how important it is for us as young people, for young people in our community to get engaged.
United Way VIP develops and places ethnically diverse and underrepresented populations into leadership roles in nonprofit agencies in order to create a more open and caring community. Council members Archibong and Hall co-hosted a senior appreciation event where residents enjoyed refreshments and watched the movie Carmen Jones. The 1954 movie is part of the Black Vintage Movie series, and Hall and Archibong brought the movie to them.
This is a community comprised 100% of older Atlantans, and they have trailblazed for us, and they've been supportive of what's made Atlanta great. So it's very important to give back and to let them know how valuable they are to us and how much we appreciate the contribution that they make. And we want to just show that through small acts of kindness, if you will.
Archibong has long been an advocate for seniors. Each year she sponsors Focus Upon Senior Services, an informational fair for senior citizens to pick up useful facts about city services. Change the world on your own street. That's the motto of a local organization in Atlanta's Eastlake community, and they are truly improving lives one senior at a time.
Celebration is in the air as neighbors gather to support neighbor in need.
We help low-income elderly homeowners in Eastlake, Kirkwood, and Edgewood and East Atlanta communities make emergency home repairs.
The purpose of tonight's event is to raise awareness and funds for this nonprofit organization that serves seniors in East Atlanta.
So many of the seniors who are living on fixed incomes are in huge peril when they have a catastrophic system failure of their house. If a roof goes like this one, or plumbing issues, it can easily go into the thousands of dollars. And if you're living on, you know, $1,100 a month, your Social Security or fixed income, you just can't afford to make repairs properly.
Councilwoman Archibong joined the festivities to offer her support.
Madeline Archibong.
I've been involved with Neighbor in Need since it started, and I've taken great pleasure in being able to, from time to time, through legislation, provide financial support for the great work that they do. And let me say this, 100% of the dollars received by Neighbor in Need is used to actually make home repairs.
Today, the neighbor in need is Elizabeth Johnson. The roof in her bathroom caved in after days of heavy rain.
And I heard this sound big, boom, 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 and I'm like, oh my God, what in the world is that? It was the bathroom right over the bathtub. It had just caved in.
IG Christmas Roofing is partnering with Neighbor in Need and repairing the roof at an affordable cost to the homeowner.
And I'm like, oh my God, I just thank the Lord for someone to care, because you know the insurance, you don't, you paying for something thinking you got covered there, especially with weather, and then you get turned down, and I didn't know nothing else to do. I'm just so thankful and grateful that, and the company that you all with look out for people like me.
Neighbor in Need has been doing good works in the community for nearly 10 years, and it's completely operated by volunteers who want to make a difference in their community. For more information on how you can contribute, log on to neighborinneed.org or call 770-367-2471. DTLR, the nation's top urban fashion retailer, provides free football camps with NFL stars for 8th to 12th grade athletes. Councilman Michael Bond was there to show his gratitude for all they do in the community. Jonathan Babineau, Chauncey Davis, and Daniel Wilcox teach students valuable on-the-gridiron football techniques as well as off-the-field skills necessary to succeed.
We appreciate these athletes giving back to these young men, because for all of us who played football, I mean, it is a dream to be in the NFL. So they've actually got real live role models for in the form of these NFL and former NFL players that can teach them not only about the fundamentals of the game, but talk about the fundamentals of life.
Atlanta is the only city where DTLR provides a free two-day camp that includes a 7-on-7 invitational. The football camps are part of DTLR's community outreach program to provide opportunities to young people who may not be able to afford to attend any kind of camp. Reading while on summer vacation, we'll show you why that really is a good idea. And we'll take you to Piedmont Park for the Atlanta Jazz Festival. That's next. Ah, they have the right idea. Lawn chairs in the park. District 9 residents joined Councilmember Felicia Moore for a jazz concert in Grove Park. They brought blankets, picnic baskets, and folding chairs for an afternoon of cool, smooth jazz.
We wanted to bring it to the community, and so it's free just like all the other events that they would have in Piedmont Park. For those who couldn't make it to Piedmont Park, they had the opportunity to come right in their own neighborhood.
They were also grooving in John White Park with Councilmember Keisha Bottoms, listening to the mellow sounds of J.O. Wyatt, Jay Henry, and Milkshake.
This is the third year we've done this. This year we've included the Young Middle School and Mays High School jazz ensembles, which was a really, really big treat just to see the young people out here. It's summertime, there's so many other places they could be, but they came out here to entertain the community.
The Office of Cultural Affairs produces annual neighborhood concerts that celebrate jazz in venues throughout Metro Atlanta. The concerts entertain and expose music lovers to the rich heritage of jazz. And the city wrapped up another great year with the Atlanta Jazz Festival. The 2013 festival in Piedmont Park was a huge success. According to festival organizers, nearly 100,000 people flocked to the park over the Memorial Day weekend for family fun, delicious food, and of course, great jazz music. The commemoration of the Battle of Atlanta is coming up in July, and if you want to get your Civil War history fix ahead of the event, the Cyclorama is your destination.
Amid the gun smoke blanketing the mountain, lay 2,500 federal troops killed and wounded.
The Atlanta Cyclorama recently converted its film, The Atlanta Campaign, which patrons view before entering the exhibit, to the digital format. The conversion brings the film by Kirk Wooster to life with vivid colors and sound. It explains the events leading up to and including the Battle of Atlanta, which ended with a Confederate defeat by Union General William Sherman. The Cyclorama is also waiving admission for active military personnel and their families between now and Labor Day. The free admission is a collaboration between the city, the Blue Star Families, and other organizations. Blue Star Families began in 2008 and works to support and connect military families. Students across Atlanta always look forward to summer vacation, but those months of freedom have a cost. Summer learning loss. Mayor Reed kicked off his summer reading club to counteract the effect summer vacation has on reading skills. Reed paid a visit to the Children's Museum to read Amari's Adventure to a group of kids.
Amari called Dad from downstairs. Wake up! It's your special day with Mama and Will.
PNC Bank donated 10,000 books to the effort to be distributed between libraries, recreation centers, and other institutions. To see which books are available and where you can find them, visit iamatlanta.org. Once your kids have read their summer reading list and they are ready to go outside and play, the city is chock full of fun for kids. The city recently opened its splash pads and pools to the public for the summer. They're a good way to stay cool on hot days. All of the city's splash pads are free to the public, while there is a small fee to swim at one of the city's public pools. For more information, visit atlantaga.gov. If you want to see the largest mammal to ever walk the earth, we'll take your family to the Fernbank Museum of Natural History, where extreme mammals are on display all summer long. The exhibit gives visitors a close look at unique features from some of the large land mammals that were around millions of years ago. Extreme Mammals is on display until August. And from real to fantastic creatures, the Atlanta Botanical Garden is currently running its Imaginary Worlds display. Tour the gardens and see these amazing creations throughout the park. Impressive sculptures, including a snake, a unicorn, and this fearsome troll, have been brought to life with plants and flowers. For more information, contact the Atlanta Botanical Garden. Thank you for watching City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel.